Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening, Reverend Levy. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I think we are just about at 6:30 now, but we usually give a little time, minute or two, for others to come on board. I'm trying to see if I am seeing our guest. Is Reverend Miller, sorry, is Dr. Baldwin Miller there? Is she online? Dr. Miller? I see a guest. I'm not sure who that is. I think Deacon Ralston is going to start by sharing a song, and then we will go into the meeting. Hopefully, by that time, others would have signed on. You would never leave.
times I feel alone, I know that you are here. My heart just wants to follow.
Thank you, Deacon Elaine. That is quite a reflective song for us. Lead me, Lord, I will go. Where you lead, we will follow. We are going to tonight have a very interesting discussion, and I hope it will, you know, be one that will be, you know, stimulate some conversation once we have had our presentation. Just want to welcome you all for taking the time to join with us here on the Boulevard Baptist Church Health and Wellness Empowerment Session. We realize that it is Father's Day, and some persons would have had, you know, things going on during the course of the day after church and so on. But you have taken the time to come, and that's great. Thank you. The person that we have on this evening, I will introduce later, but she's Dr. Janique Baldwin-Miller, a psychiatrist. And as you know from what was advertised already, we are going to be looking at Alzheimer's and dementia. I know that this has come up for discussion recently quite a bit, in fact, I've gone to one or two sessions that are held by other persons, but it is a topic that I think all of us have an interest in, because we've either been involved with caring for someone with Alzheimer's or dementia, and or we know someone who has one or the other. And I hope that this evening we'll kind of understand what is the difference, if any, between Alzheimer's and dementia. So thank you all for taking the time to come, and thank Dr. Baldwin-Miller for taking the time too, because I know she had a commitment earlier herself. I'm going to ask our Deacon Elaine to start with prayer for us, and so that we can, you know, launch off into our discussion. We want to give full time for the presentation and discussion. Please, Deacon Elaine.
Let us pray. Almighty God, maker of this entire world, Father of us all, Savior, Provider, Healer, Friend. We worship you, Lord, because you are the one true and living God. Great God, there's none like you. And Lord, we are in such awe of your greatness. Father, when we consider the oceans, the moon, the stars, and your general creation, we see just how great you are. Mm-hmm. Yet, you all-powerful God, you love us. You love us while we are still sinners. And your word tells us that your love has no bounds. Father, as we meet this afternoon for another empowerment session, we ask that you will enable our presenter to disseminate the information in a clear manner and allow us, Lord, to have receptive yet inquiring minds. Father, you have enabled us to learn so much from these sessions over the period, and we are grateful that we are able from our diverse locations to participate. Lord, we ask that you give us the courage to not just learn this information, but to share the knowledge gained with others, as well as to use it when necessary for the benefit of all. Father, your word tells us that an intelligent heart acquires knowledge, and the heir of the wise seeks knowledge.
You have Zoom on your phone. All you had to do was put in the meeting.
Lord, help us to both acquire knowledge, because we learn that the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of him who has it. Thank you for everyone here, Father, and help us, Lord, to participate with the intention of using this knowledge to help ourselves and others. We thank you for everything as we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Deacon Elaine. I'm just going to make a request, though. Can we just make sure that we have muted, you know, our microphones, please? Everybody just look on your tablet or whatever now and make sure that you have muted it, okay? I still see one that is open, K92, right? Please mute all of them. All right, thank you. All right, so I'm going to now introduce Dr. Baldwin Miller. It's my pleasure to introduce her. We just met recently. I was introduced to her by someone else as someone who would be able to really address this topic adequately and generate some discussions around it. So Dr. Janique Baldwin Miller is a psychiatrist who provides mental health services to a wide variety of clients with emotional and behavioral problems. She has earned her doctorate in psychiatry from the University of the West Indies, Mona, and this was in 2019. And she also graduated with her doctoral degree from the University of the West Indies, medical doctor's degree from the University of the West Indies in 2011. So she's had a little time out there. And she's done a bachelor's of science degree, biological sciences from Northern Caribbean University in 2004. Currently, Dr. Baldwin Miller is employed by the Southern Region Health Authority, where she's the psychiatrist for the parish of St. Elizabeth. She also has a vibrant private practice at Surgical and Medical Associates Black River Limited, and psychiatrist to Micromediations. And I think she will explain that what that is apparently some retreat. Dr. Baldwin Miller is passionate about her faith and providing hope and love for her patients and their families. She's married to Alston Miller, and mother of Austin Alexander Baldwin Miller. And I think another one is on the way. Another Mr. Miller or Miss Miller. Anyway, Dr. Baldwin Miller, thank you for joining us. And I'm going to ask you now to go ahead and start with your sharing.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Thanks again for your introduction and thanks for having me. Happy Father's Day, everyone, all our men in the group. Let me see if I can share. Can you?
Yes, it looks good. We are seeing.
All right, let me just put up share.
You want to go to slideshow?
Yes, I'm trying to find the icon.
You come across to your girls, come across to your right some more, my right.
Okay.
Up. Go up.
Stop sharing.
Up. No, go. I'm up. Trying. You're not seeing
up
it.
Further.
Yeah, come back to where you were before. Just kind of halfway along the page. All right. Your cursor is down too low. You have to go up. Yes, that's it.
Okay, I think I found it.
Wonderful. Right, wonderful. Yes.
This wonderful technology.
Yes.
All right. So So I'm going to be talking about Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. So let's just look at this one. To just give a brief introduction on normal aging and what to expect in normal aging, and then let's look at some of the other things that can happen when someone has had some veering from normal aging. So the pathway from youth to old age is characterized by the shift from the pursuit of wealth, which that's what I'm trying to do right now, to the maintenance of health, because of normal decline in function. Despite this, the normal state in the aged is actually physical, sexual, and mental health. Not illness and debilitation. So yes, there's a decline in functioning as we age, but overall there should be maintenance of good physical health, good sexual health, and good mental health. I know we should have a discussion afterwards, question and answer afterwards, but if you want to stop me, please go ahead, because I like to have a vibrant discussion. I don't know if that's okay, Mrs. Watson Campbell.
Yeah. Oh, that's fine. Thank you. That's okay. So what's comfortable for you?
Sure. All right, so statistics show that 75% of persons 65 to 74 years of age describe their health as good. So that's the majority of that population. Healthy older persons usually maintain similar levels of social activity compared to their earlier years. So they're the type of person that used to like to go to church when they're younger. That should not change as they grow older. They like to play tennis when they're young. That's something that they would normally would want to be like sewing. They like hiking, bicycle riding. Those things usually would continue in older years. So ideally, old age is a period of continued growth in intellect and emotional well-being. So the idea is to get older and wiser until you pass away, right? That is the ideal. However, sometimes this is not the case, and persons may develop cognitive impairment or issues with their physical health that affects their functioning. Now, I'm going to be focusing on the decline in cognitive health. And we usually group this generalized decline and dysfunction into a group of disorders called dementia. To be more specific, in the diagnostic statistical manual that psychiatrists use, we usually refer to dementia as major neurocognitive disorder. And I'm going to be looking at the different types based on what is causing the dementia. So dementia is a disease process called marked by progressive cognitive impairment in clear consciousness. So the person is not comatose and having some cognitive deficits, or in not delirious and having some cognitive deficit. They're wide awake, they're alert, they're aware of what is going on. They can see, they can hear, they're fully aware, but there's some decline in some of the cognitive domains, which we're going to be looking at later. So this is actually a decline from previous functioning. So before, there was optimal functioning. They were the banker, the teacher, etc. And then you notice that there was a decline in their job. So this is different from persons that have intellectual disability, where that is more from a developmental disorder, where the cognitive decline starts, or the cognitive deficits start from developmental periods in infancy, in childhood, right? So dementia involves multiple cognitive domains, and cognitive deficits cause significant impairment in functioning. So you wouldn't say somebody has dementia if there is no significant decline in function. You have to have issues with cognitive decline and significant deficits in the different cognitive domains, and then significant impairments in functioning. So this could be social functioning, occupational functioning, all right? So the disorder can be progressive or static. So progressive means that there's mild deficits and then there's gradual decline to major deficits. And then there can be, static, where they had a stroke and now they have difficulty remembering their name and where they are, or operating machineries that they used to, right? And then usually there is no further decline after that initial insult. So we call that static. And then there can be permanent deficits. So the person has deficits in these cognitive domains, which we're going to be talking about later. And no matter what, it cannot be reversed, or there's decline and it's caught early and then it's reversible. So approximately 15% of people with dementia have reversible illness if treatment is initiated before irreversible damage takes place. And so that is why it's very important that when you notice that your loved one is having some cognitive decline and it's affecting their function, that you seek medical help as soon as possible, because they could fall in the 15% of persons with a reversible form of dementia, and it can be picked up when appropriately investigated, and some kind of treatment can be implemented for those persons. So these are the cognitive domains that I was talking about earlier. And so the first one is memory and learning. So this includes, for example, short-term memory. Where did I put my wallet? Where did I go for church today? Where did I, what did I have for lunch? Did I really eat lunch today? That's your short-term memory. And then you have long-term memory deficits. Was I married? Do I have children? How many children do I have? What are the names of the children? Those are long-term memory issues. And learning new tasks. Those that cognitive domain can have to have two or more of the cognitive domains affected before they can qualify to be diagnosed with dementia. Then there's issues with attention. So you notice that the person has difficulty focusing on tasks, example, reading books, and they're watching TV, they can't follow, they're playing games, and it's difficult for them to follow in the game and do well. Not because they're just not able to, you know, perform at this game, but just have difficulty paying attention and focusing to even carry out the different tasks associated with effectively playing a particular game. Then there's issues with personality. There's personality changes where the person's mood and behavior changes, and it's persistent and consistent. So, for example, their mood, they might be more irritable than usual. They may be more labile, crying 1 minute, laughing the next. They might appear very docile. In terms of their behavior, they might be withdrawn. They might be socially disinhibited. So, making, for example, sexual jokes or touching persons inappropriately. Things like that might start happening when there's a change in the personality, or they may be changing their language where they have difficulty understanding or communicating. So they're sometimes repeating themselves in a sentence. You're speaking with them and it just seems as if they can't understand what you're saying. There's issues with executive functioning. So there's concern about planning and performing complex tasks like driving, getting dressed, preparing food, and also visual spatial perception is lost or very much affected. So there's changes in recognizing objects. Can you identify this object? Unable to identify a pen or a cell phone or a computer, much less to use it. They have difficulty recognizing faces. They have issues with hand-eye coordination. So the tools that they used to use in their trade, they have difficulty using it. So for example, you have a dressmaker. She's not sure how to operate this machine anymore because of this cognitive domain that is affected. So as I had mentioned earlier, there are different types of dementias depending on the cause. And the most common type of dementia is due to Alzheimer's disease. And as I said, that's the most common type. Then you have vascular dementia, which is the second most common. And this is usually due to increased cardiovascular risk factors. So persons that have diabetes, hypertension, and are having multiple strokes in their brain, then that can affect the different cognitive domains and it can present with dementia. Other forms of dementia, which you might be familiar with, is dementia due to HIV. So somebody can contract HIV, and the late stage of HIV, the virus affects their brain, and then they can have significant cognitive deficits and dysfunction, and then we would say they have dementia due to HIV, or they have Parkinson's disease, and they fulfill the criteria for on the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. And then later on into their illness, then they start having memory impairment. And then we'd say that they would have dementia due to Parkinson's disease. So the development and course of dementia is usually gradual and progressive, and it results into severe dementia and eventually leading to death. The mean duration of survival after diagnosis is about 10 years. So after someone has been diagnosed with dementia, then their life expectancy is about 10 years. And this may be much less or much more depending on some of the risk factors that they have, such as if they have a strong family history of dementia and they have early onset dementia, then they might progress much faster. So the late stage eventually leads to persons being mute and bedbound. And death in most cases are due to underlying medical issues such as aspiration. So they have difficulty controlling their airway and their eating, and they're aspirating the food into their airway. And that's the most common cause for their passing. So because of the cognitive decline associated with dementia, there's a lot of safety issues that we have to take into consideration when a person is diagnosed with dementia. For example, there's issues concerning suicidal ideations. This might occur in the early stages of the illness when the person still has insights, they know that they do have this illness, they understand that they are going to have significant decline and significant dependence on their loved ones. And this might be quite disheartening, and it can lead to depression and suicidal ideations. Other safety issues to consider is agitation. So this is the moderate to severe stage when persons can become very agitated and become very aggressive, and they might hurt themselves or hurt others. And at this time, we have to definitely rule out any underlying medical causes for the agitation. So is the person having some chest pain and they're having pain and they become agitated, or they're having some abdominal discomfort and they're becoming agitated? So definitely want to rule out medical issues before I'm jumping to say, oh, this is just the dementia that is causing it. So persons that are very agitated may require one-on-one care. They might need medication and rarely hospitalization. Also, there's issues concerning falls. And this could be due to the medication that they're on that can cause significant sedation or cardiovascular side effects, such as lowering of their blood pressure, they cause dizziness. So it's very important to modify their environment, whatever may be the cause for the risk of falls. So this may include moving rugs, lowering their beds, make sure they have good lighting in the areas that they're going to be traversing, remove electrical cords so they're not going to be having a risk of falling and tripping. And sometimes persons decide that they would want to engage in physiotherapy to improve balance and strengthening of the muscles, so that there's a less likelihood for their loved ones to fall. Also, there's issues concerning poisoning. So a person with cognitive decline and severe dementia is like a child again. It's very important to remove or lock up cleaning and household products, such as paint thinners and bleaches, etc., because they can take this up and ingest it unknowingly. And then that is another significant medical emergency that you're going to have to deal with. Also, consider fire as a safety issue. So you would want to remove or lock up matches to secure the stove and the gas. And if the person smokes cigarettes, then you'd want to discontinue their cigarettes use, because they can easily light cigarettes and then leave it, and then that's a fire hazard. So other safety issues you have to take into consideration is elder abuse. And once those signs are noticed, then as healthcare workers, as friends, as caregivers, you have to assess it and evaluate it and make any reports if necessary. There's also risk of financial exploitation, neglect, and etc. So we have to be mindful of these things and report it to the relevant authorities. This is quite common, and that is something that we definitely can't ignore and turn a blind eye to. For persons with mild neurocognitive disorder, we'd want to limit driving. So they might you'd want to probably limit driving to just familiar locations, encourage modest speeds, and there should be good visibility. She shouldn't be a rainy day or foggy day. And the roads should be relatively relatively clear. So this would be in the mild form of the disorder. And sometimes maybe they need just a chaperone to assist them driving, because you want to maintain independence as long as possible and in a safe way as possible. So you'd have to try and strike a balance. And the same principle applies for other equipment, such as firearms, aircrafts, and lawnmowers. So with this cognitive decline, it's very important to focus on advanced planning. And it's important to allow patients to participate in decision-making, such as the use of medications. Would they want to be assisted in feeds with feeding tubes or artificial life support? You'd want them to participate in research about their illness, about the different treatments that are available for them, the different type of care that they would want. Is it home care or maybe an institutional care? Also, there's issues regarding a durable power of attorney. It's important to discuss with them a living will, advanced directive. Some of these things don't have significant legal standing in Jamaica, but with the guidance of a lawyer, then whatever decisions that are made, hopefully it can stand in the time when the patient needs it the most. Also, it's important to discuss home care and institutional care, vulnerability to exploitation, and if me as a physician isn't comfortable with advising the person, then definitely I would refer them for financial and legal advice as needs be.
Dr. Baldwin Miller, can I just come in here a minute?
Sure.
Right. Are you saying that this kind of discussion should be had with a person once you realize that they could be having that diagnosis? Or would you say that all persons going into old age, meaning you, I think you had said something about 65 to whatever, I'm not too sure what the age that you had said there at the beginning. But when it is likely so to have an
dementia, dementia can start at 50, between 50 and 60 years old.
Okay, so would you say though, that instead of waiting to see that someone is possibly going to, you know, have dementia, should we be advising people to that these are some of the things that they could be looking at before they even get a diagnosis like that? You know, just like how you are advised to write a will, put it that way. You know, is that something that you think that we should all have as discussion, you know, with our family members and so on? If I have this kind of diagnosis, this is what I would like to have happen.
I would recommend, of course, that a discussion like that is had before a diagnosis of dementia is made. But also persons shy away from having such a discussion.
Yeah.
However, if it's not done before the onset, it's not too late to do it early on in the diagnosis, especially not just you, but with your siblings or the brothers and sisters of the person that is ill. So that it's not a one-man show and persons are not excluded. And it reminds me to also say that sometimes the normal aging process is, dementia is mistaken as a normal aging process. And when you start seeing some kind of signs, it's important not to ignore it, but to use the opportunity to say, okay, I noticed there's some decline. These are some concerns I have. What do you think we should do about this, that, etc.? I hope I answered your question.
Oh, yeah. Yes, you have.
Okay.
Yeah, I just think people do shy away from things like that, just like how they shy away from making a will.
Yes. You know?
So it's something that we need to start confronting as just normal conversation.
Sure. So just like you have a child and you discuss with your partner about starting college or going to high school and what vocation they're going to be taking up. I mean, we definitely have to do long-term, medium-term, short-term planning for our loved ones at this stage of their life. I think Aberna Edwards wanted to say something.
Yes, good. Good evening, Doc.
Good evening.
I have a friend who at 90 seems to be going through dementia. But I think the family has left it untreated. What are your thoughts?
So again, a lot of persons think that dementia is a normal part of aging. It is okay to become senile, quote unquote, when you become 90 or 95 or 100 or 70, 85, etc. So some persons might normalize it, or some person might be in denial about it. And if I am, for example, someone in that situation where I know that this person is going through this issue with their family member, then I would gently try and, you know, show my concern and say, you know, maybe this could be the route that they could take in caring for their loved one. But I definitely would go into that prayerfully, because persons can become quite defensive when you're addressing topics like that.
Okay, thank you.
But if there's issues regarding neglect or abuse, then definitely have to have a strong word and show your concern and then report it to the relevant persons in your community. All right, so going back to transition to assisted living, this is also when there's a high risk and there's a lot of safety issues concerned, then this is something that we usually consider for persons with dementia. So the first and the best option for older adults is to remain in their own homes. And it's what we call aging in place for as long as possible. However, to stay healthy and safe, individuals who live independently typically have the ability to prepare their own meals, take any required medications, and take a shower or bath each day. However, there are some signs that you might say, okay, this person might not be fit for living alone and might need some assistance in living. And this may include, but not limited to, soiled clothing, an unkept appearance, unintended weight loss or gain. So this usually happens when persons are forgetting that they've had meals. And so they would go an entire day without eating because they just did not realize that they had not eaten. Or they might gain weight because they forgot that they ate and then would eat. And so they would gain a lot of weight. In my practice, a lot of patients would complain to their children that, you know, I'm here and the caregiver hasn't fed me, or I'm here with my sister-in-law, my daughter-in-law all day and she hasn't fed me. And, you know, you have to take that into consideration, that maybe they're forgetting. And if there isn't any issues with weight loss or weight gain, then you're wondering if this could be due to, these complaints may be due to the cognitive decline that they're having. So also there's an increase in medical symptoms such as pain, dizziness, or confusion might result in medications, I think, taken incorrectly. So so they're, again, not taking their medication properly. So the pressure has gone up and they become dizzy, or they're not taking their antihypertensive, but there's on the other hand, they could be overtaking it and the blood pressure falls and they become dizzy. And then, you know, that's increased risk for falls and other injuries. There's a neglect of household chores, so the place doesn't seem kept as usual. There's frequent falls and repeated hospitalizations because of improper taking of their medication, etc. There's some signs of dehydration or malnutrition, other signs of neglect, disconnected lights. So they've forgotten to pay their light bill. They have the money, but they haven't the abstract thinking and the decision making and all that executive functioning and planning is affected, and so realize that they don't have any light for weeks or months, and you know, you're wondering what is happening. This might be an indication that maybe living alone is not a good idea anymore. Just wandering away from home, insufficient funds. So they're not able to take care of their basic needs, or they're just feeling very lonely. And it's an added stress that can worsen their cognitive function. So going quickly to treatment. So there is behavioral oriented treatment where you want to redirect the individual when they're doing certain things. So you notice that they're putting on some clothes that they wouldn't usually dress in. So you would redirect them gently. There's stimulation oriented treatment where you would engage in regular recreation that they enjoy, which include art, music, or pet therapy. There's emotional oriented therapy. And this is usually in the early stage of the disease, where you are giving them a listening ear and helping them to process their feelings and their emotions about having this illness. And there's cognitive oriented treatment where there's skills training, and they might be forgetting some things, or they've had a stroke, for example, and there's this one time off significant or moderate cognitive decline, and they forget to do certain things, and so you have to reorient them into doing certain activities with assistance, and maybe hopefully the brain is a very plastic organ, thank God, so there is some regeneration that can occur, and so skills training is definitely not something that you want to put away, because you say, okay, this person is at this stage and will not regain any functioning after this stage. Also, there's issues with medication or concerns or use of medication in persons with dementia. And this is usually for associated symptoms. So it's not usually for cure or improving improvement of the illness, but it's associated with improving issues like agitation, if there's issues with sleep, if the patient has developed any psychotic symptoms, so they're seeing things and hearing things, and we might use medication to help improve some of those symptoms and make caregiving more bearable. Also, persons with things like vascular dementia, to reduce the risk of further deterioration, then ensuring that they're on appropriate antihypertensives and their medication for their diabetes will help to reduce the progression, the fast progression of the illness. So wrapping up quickly, I just wanted to look at some tips for caregivers taking care of persons with dementia. So it's very important to keep a routine, such as bathing and dressing and eating at the same time each day. Help the person to write down to-do lists for their appointments and events in a notebook or calendar, so that they can maintain some kind of independence and get to do some of the things that they'd want to do and as much as possible. Also, it's important that you plan activities that the person enjoys and try to do them at the same time each day. For example, they like news at certain times, so you turn on the radio so they can listen to the news. They like to take their walk. They like to visit a friend or so. Then you try to plan activities so that they can carry out these things that they enjoy as long as possible. Consider systems of reminding about medication. When dressing or bathing, allow the person to do as much as possible. So, you might need to, remember how to assist them in adjusting the temperature of the of the water, or, you know, getting the towel and rag, but you could probably just allow them to shower themselves by themselves, as long as they're able to, you realize that they're able to do that without assistance. Also consider buying loose fitting, comfortable, easy to use clothing, such as clothes with elastic waistbands, fabric fasteners, or large zipper plus pulls instead of shoelaces, buttons, and buckles, so that they can have some independence in dressing themselves. So the safety in the shower, we try and have a chair that they can probably use to sit in. If you realize that they're unsteady on their feet, but they still are able to bathe themselves, you can allow them to have as much independence as possible. You will definitely want to be gentle with them, and respectful. So you don't just, put them into the bath and say, come in here, and you start taking off their clothes and you put them into the shower. You're trying to explain to them, no, we're going to have a bath. No, I'm going to be taking off your clothes. We're going to let you sit down in the shower, etc. So that they're confused, and you don't want them to be more confused by not explaining what you're doing. So you'd also want to serve meals in a consistent familiar place and give the person enough time to have their meals. So you realize that they're not eating as fast as possible, and you say, okay, I'm like, you don't want the food, just take it up and discard of it. You give them as much time as possible, that you know that they can have their meals and nourish themselves adequately. Again, you want to reassure the person, speak calm, listen to his or her concerns and frustrations. Try to show that you understand if the person is angry or fearful. So a patient might say, who is that person? Who's that person coming and helping me? I don't know who that is, And when they steal my things, and you have to be so careful. Make sure you're watching them, And so, that person could just be their husband, but they don't recognize their husband, and they might be very concerned and frustrated. But it's important for you to show and that you understand that they're frustrated because they don't realize who this person is, and to empathize with them. You're not going to kiss the teacher and roll your eyes and say, that is your husband. You want to say, I realize you're frustrated because you don't know who that person is, and you're in a safe place, and we're here to take care of you, and everything is going to be okay, right? Again, allow the person to keep as much control in his or her life as possible. Respect the person's personal space. I know persons who have used the individual's house, because they have been diagnosed with dementia. They said, okay, let's turn their house into a nursing home. It's win-win. You'd want to discuss that with them first, of course. You want to discuss about sharing rooms and, how comfortable they're with things like that. You definitely want to have a discussion before you sew it on them. But build quiet time in the day along with activities. So yes, you're going to, try to engage them as much as possible, but then also you'd want to have quiet time. Keep well-loved objects and photographs around the house to help the person feel more secure. Remind the person who you are if he or she doesn't remember, but try not to say, don't you remember? Because then, that can be more distressing for them. So what, really? I can't remember. I'm supposed to remember you. And that can be even more distressing to the person. You want to encourage a two-way conversation for as long as possible. So you want to talk with the person and try to get them to talk with you. Some person are not very good at that. So you might want to use familiar books or photo albums to help to make the communication a little bit more free flow. So again, these are another examples of things that you can do with the person. If they can manage chores around the house, you want to engage them and do these things as long as they're able to, with supervision, of course, if needs be. You want to join activities such as exercise. So persons with dementia might not be so willing to initiate activities, but if you are able to start it for them and do it with them, then they might be willing, they're more willing to participate. You want to definitely buy a variety of healthy foods and give them the options. So, you know, say here, this is the cheese, this cheese today for lunch. You can ask them, give them some autonomy. Would you like some yogurt or would you like some cheese today? Things like that can make them feel more like they are part of the process. So this is my last slide before I end. Just want to look at taking care of yourself as the caregiver. So person with dementia, again, is not fully aware of what is going on. And the caregiver is fully aware of what is going on and has all the strain and the stress and the frustration and sometimes guilt and all the negative emotions and positive emotions surrounding caring for your caregiver who is unwell. So it's very important as a caregiver to ask for help when you need it. So even if it's just a break to go to the bank, some child leave the person alone or and just go to the bank and come back, and then when you're at the bank and the person's all alone and they're fretting the whole time, is the person safe? If you feel like you need to hire somebody or ask somebody to assist and come over and assist in that short period of time or even a long period of time, ask for the help. It's important for you to eat healthy, nutritious foods. If you have a caregiver support group that is near you or online, then it's very important to seek out these groups, and it can be very helpful to reduce isolation. And these persons are sharing their frustrations, their concerns, their joys, and how they do things, and you could probably even learn from them. So that is something that you can definitely consider in the whole tools in caring for ourselves when we are caring for someone with dementia. It's important to take breaks each day. Try to take a cup of tea or call a friend. Do something for yourself that you enjoy. Spend time with friends and keep up with hobbies. Get exercise as often as you can. It can be yoga or going for a walk. You can even walk with the person that you're caring for. It would be good for both of you. Also, meditation is something that you can practice. Mindfulness meditation help you to manage some of those negative emotions and help you to cope better. And so it's also shown that it's very helpful when caregivers take on a practice like this. Also consider seeking help from mental health professionals to help you cope with stress and anxiety. So if you're finding that you're overwhelmed, you're not sleeping, you're feeling depressed, very tearful, you used to enjoy taking care for your elderly mother and, you know, assisting her, you know, but it now becomes burdensome and you're feeling overwhelmed and you just don't have any energy, then you would want to seek help and seek help from a professional. And because there's a risk of you developing depression or anxiety And it is not unusual that the stress of caring for your loved one with dementia can put you at risk for developing cognitive issues yourself. So when you see the early signs, I would suggest that you get help. So that is it for my presentation. I hope that it was helpful. And if there's any questions.
Can I ask a question?
Sure, go ahead.
Must apologize that I wasn't in for the first part, so you may have covered that. Can I prevent that happening to me, getting dementia or Alzheimer? What should I do?
Okay, so as I said before, there are different types of dementia. Alzheimer's is one type. There's usually a genetic component to Alzheimer's disease. So there's a genetic component and there's an environmental component such as stressors. Persons who have good premorbid functioning, they are actively using their brain. After retirement, they don't just go home and sit down and just, you know, not do anything. They're actively engaging. That can reduce their risk of developing, eating healthy, exercising, staying in contact with your social circle, are some of those factors that can reduce your risk of developing this Alzheimer's, dementia, vascular dementia. As I said before, the risk factor is cardiovascular disease such as hypertension and diabetes. So you definitely want to make sure that you're taking your medications, having your diabetes and your hypertension under control, and that will reduce your risk significantly in developing an illness like that.
Okay, I don't have those. Thanks. Thank you.
Okay. You're welcome.
Okay, we are open now for some questions and answers. We have a little time. I would encourage you to ask as quickly as you can. Thank you so much, Dr. Baldwin Miller. Very clearly presented.
Thank you.
If welcome. I might.
Yes, please.
I shared something in the chat, but I don't know whether or not Dr. Yes. Baldwin Miller will get an opportunity to see. But the point about the caregiver paying attention to himself or herself is seriously important, because I've seen in a number of instances where the caregivers die leaving the person that they are taking care of, because there is just so much that they have to contend with.
Yes.
And in a number of instances, they don't even get a chance to get a little breather, to go out and to be away and, you know, this sort of thing. So I think that point must always be underscored.
Yes, for sure. Yes.
Definitely.
Anybody else?
Yes, Sister Pauline.
Yes, please.
Yes, good evening, Dr. Miller, Baldwin Miller. My mother is 93 and she has no medical condition except glaucoma. But I have the issue of I had to take her from her home, her house. And so she's now with me in Kingston. I appreciate it. It's still a bit strange. But she's constantly wanting to go home, can't find her clothes.
Mm-hmm.
And is always, you know, looking, searching, and of course, blaming everybody in the house that they have taken her clothes and so on and so forth. Is there anything that I can do at the house itself at this time where I am to lessen the incidence of you know, those occasions?
Well, is she having issues with her sight because of the glaucoma?
Yes, she does. She does, because she sees all kinds of things and, you know, yes.
That are not there. Okay. So that can happen with persons that are having impaired vision. But I would suggest that you get her assessed to see if she's developing dementia. And it could be something that is reversible that you'd want to get treatment for. And then your healthcare provider can assist you in helping to provide an environment that is more conducive to her being less confused. So I forgot what I was gonna say. So yes, so she could be living alone and developing this illness and no one realized because, you know, nobody was paying keen attention. This is something that you want to get a full medical examination and to get to rule out any other medical issues along with the dementia.
She has done a lot of like CAT scan and those kind of things, and there's nothing physiological.
Okay. So as I'd mentioned before, ensuring that the place is properly lit, having familiar things around her. So I mean, it's just an area that she is mostly located, then you'd want to, you know, regularly reorient her to the environment. You know, remember the chair is there, remember, you know, the bathrooms are on the corner, so she can easily navigate the environment as best as possible.
Yes. I realize that it has reached a stage where she has even forgotten her own children.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. That's something that as if they're, maybe she gets a second opinion. Maybe there's something there going on. So, because some clinicians are still not aware that, you know, you know, they might normalize this forgetfulness and say, okay, it's just normal aging when it is actually early onset dementia. So, you know, it's important to just try and get her properly assessed. Because you're not supposed to be forgetting your children's age or names, etc.
So, Doc.
All right, Doc. Thanks.
You're welcome.
So, Doc, you had mentioned children of a mother who had dementia may also encounter that disease.
Yes, sir. I mentioned that there's some genetic component to developing dementia. So if your immediate family members have it, then you are at increased risk of developing it. And so you'd want to keep an eye out, ensure that you get your yearly checkup and get your cognitive assessment checked by your doctor. If you have any concerns about it, mention it to your doctor, because most times when patients present, for example, to the psychiatrist, it's been going on for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. When they're wandering away and getting lost, that's when they come to the doctor, when they you know, they could have gotten treatments and start making preparations for the progression of the illness long before that those final stages.
As I mentioned before, I had missed the first half, so I didn't hear what were the signs that you had to look out for.
Okay, so there's issues with, so the acronym is MAPLES. So there's issues with memory. Mm-hmm. So they're short-term and long-term memory is impaired. There's issues with attention. So you're talking with them, they're reading and they're not able to follow. Then they're playing games, they're not able to follow. Their personality changes. So their behavior, their mood is different. They're having issues with communication. They're not able to carry out different functions as they used to, like cooking, going out to pay their bills, etc. And sometimes family members might notice that there's a change and they start to, you know, chip in and do a little bit more here and there. And I think, you know, I'm just helping out more. But they're basically compensating to the point that they're helping the person do all these things and not realizing that, you know, something serious is going on. And sometimes when, you know, it's that caregiver passes away or migrates or something, and then the person is there by themselves and doesn't have this assistance, like a brother that used to live with their brother, or they used to live with a child and the child migrated. And then you realize that, oh my gosh, why is this person just suddenly not able to dress themselves? And all along, the person that was there was kind of chipping in and helping them go along.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Yes.
Good evening. You spoke about support group. Can you point me to one of those groups?
I don't know of any specific ones in Kingston at this time. Mm-hmm. I know in St. Elizabeth we had a caregiver support group. That kind of went downhill with COVID, but they're
yeah.
I'm not sure of any in Kingston at this time.
I do know, actually. Dr. Miller, Ronald Miller, yeah. I do know. I'm trying to remember it right now, but what I will do, I will post it in the churches, probably on some platform, I don't know, by email or something. There is a very good support group here in Kingston. In fact, I was saying I just attended one of the seminars. It was put on by them recently. The name just slipped me right now, but they are here in Kingston, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Right. And if you don't know of anyone, then form one.
Yes.
Or it's not close to you, or that one is not convenient, then try and form one in your church. You know, that you have senior citizens group. You can have a senior citizens care group.
Yeah, we have a lot of senior citizens in our church. And I would think that that is really an area that we have to be really aware of, you know, as church members and as deacons together. Yes, but I will certainly get that information. It just slipped me just now, but there is one here in Kingston as well.
Okay.
All right. Okay. No other questions? All right. Well, I am just going to do my wrap up. I just want to thank you so much, Dr. Baldwin Miller, for making it you know, so clear to us. It's a huge topic, I know, but you covered, I think, everything for us, a little bit of everything for us. And there are just a couple of takeaways that I have for myself. And the whole thing of the planning ahead strikes me as being very important. I had a personal experience with that, where my aunt actually figured out that she was, you know, having memory problems. And because there's a history of Alzheimer's in the family, she started to do her planning from quite early. So one of the things I forgot about was this power of attorney. And by the time I tried to get that done, they did this clock face test with her. I think you know what that is. I know you know. And she couldn't pass the clock face test. And so they would not deem her capable of saying I could act, you know, as her power of attorney. So
planning ahead is very important. You know, you can put aside, we can cause a lot of problems if we don't have these things in place. And the whole thing too of keeping people as occupied as possible, that is so important when people are beginning to have cognitive deficits that they are kept doing things every day. So thank you for sharing that part of it too. And that whole thing of keeping the person at home as long as you can. I know sometimes people do have to make the decision. It's a painful one of probably putting their, you know, loved ones in a home, but caring for them at home is really the best way, where they have their familiar, you know, surroundings and people to drop in and say hello and that kind of thing. And of course, as Deacon Elaine just pointed out, the whole thing of caring for yourself as the caregiver, so absolutely important. So thank you, thank you, thank you. And, you know, we wish you all the best as you continue to serve in this way, you know, down in St. Elizabeth. Happy that there are psychiatrists on that side of the world. And, you know, we pray God's special blessing on you and your family. So thank you for taking the time to come and to do this. So I'm
It was my pleasure.
Right, wonderful. Okay, I'm just going to hand over to Deacon Elaine, and I think you will complete the rest of the proceedings.
Okay, I too want to add my thank you to Dr. Baldwin Miller and to all the members who have tuned in. This was really good information. And so I'm going to just offer closing prayer, if that's what you are.
Well, I was going to ask Deacon Verna to close in prayer, and you just kicked off for us. Yes.
All right. So let me just continue where I was at.
Right.
To say thank you very much to the members on the platform. As I was saying, this is very, very important information. There are some of us, and I'm talking from experience, who have parents who not at Alzheimer's stage or dementia, but parents who need to be assisted, parents who are not well. And a number of what was said this evening are pointers that can assist us. Even the whole matter of the chair for the bath, that one, you know, a sturdy chair to sit on. Those things are important for us. And even more important, the fact that we should ask for help. Because sometimes we tend to be very private. And we don't say when we're having challenges, and we don't reach out to others for help. And this can be detrimental to our well-being as those persons who opt to be caregiver or who are overseeing some of these challenging situations. I want to just take the opportunity to say thank you to Deacon Watson Campbell, because this kind of information is very good information that we should all have, not because we are a church with a number of persons who are in the senior citizens group, but because this is information that will help us and information that we can share with others. Because you get information, it's not about, you know, keeping it to yourself. It's about disseminating it and helping to strengthen others. And many times we see persons struggling with situations. This is information that we can pull on in order to assist them. So once again, this empowerment session was really was a really good one. And I'm hoping that all of us had some takeaways from it. Thank you.
Well, thank you. This was a good reminder for me. I did it at school years ago, but, and I think one of the thoughts I would like to share is that since we have so much NCDs in Jamaica, and Dr. Miller shared that once you have vascular disease and with hypertension and diabetes, high cholesterol, those are actually factors that does affect our vascular system. So we're almost all prone to it. So we do our best to take our meds and have our NCDs controlled. So let us all pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this another day. We thank you for the privilege, Lord, of knowing you as Lord and Savior. We thank you, Lord, for Dr. Miller and the way she shared so efficiently and clear on the topic, dementia. And now we learned that Alzheimer's is named among dementia and that there are different types of dementia. So, Lord, as we have shared, this knowledge is not for ourselves only, but it's for our families, our friends, and for the wider church community. So, Lord, we pray a blessing upon Dr. Miller as she continues in her medical practice and continue to share knowledge and understanding. So, Lord, we just thank you for Boulevard Baptist, and we thank you for the opportunity to gather and to learn each week something new. So Lord, we say, bless us individually, bless us collectively. Remember our pastor who is on vacation and his family. And we pray, Lord, that you continue to protect, watch over them, and keep them safe. So be with us now and throughout this week. May we have a good week, praising God always and giving thanks. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Is Reverend here?
Yes, Reverend, good night, I'm here.
Reverend Levy, can you just do the final benediction if you have any comments?
Just want to add my thanks to Dr. Baldwin Miller for such an informative presentation, and good night to everybody, and I trust that we'll have a wonderful and restful night. Let us receive the benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen and amen.
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 Amen. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Night.
Amen.
Good night, night.
Good night, everyone.
Night, night.
Night, everybody.
Night, night.
Night.
Good night. Good night.
Night.